episode of Talkin' Baseball, the show in which we talk about baseball. This is episode 6. We're going to be talking about no-hitters. I'm your host, Pete Lincoln. With me, your other host,
Jason Smith. And I can't believe we're on episode 6 already.
That's right. But before we begin this talk tonight, I would like to talk about a specific book, a new book that's just come out called Ty Cobb, A Terrible Beauty. Ty Cobb has had a reputation of being maybe the greatest baseball player who ever lived, but also at the same time, a terrible person. His reputation as a brawler, as a mean man, as someone who went out of his way to hurt ball players, beat people up in the stands, has become increasingly more his legacy than his achievements. This book actually debunks the reason he is thought of that way. His reputation was largely built on a book which was published in 1995 by a fellow named Al Stump. Al Stump, shortly before Cobb died in 1960, spent some time with him and wrote a book which is largely fiction. It has been proven that the things that this book talks about are false, and that Stump later on took a lot of supposed artifacts of Cobb's that were given to him and sold them for tremendous profit. And this book itemizes all of these things that he did, which showed him to be a complete fraud. Cobb was a rough-tough brawler in a time when there was rough-tough brawling, but a lot of the things that supposedly he did and said and behaved simply were not true. This fellow Stump invented things. For instance, he supposedly got a hold of the shotgun that Cobb's mother used to shoot Cobb's father. It has never been proven that it was a shotgun, and the fact that some 60 years after the fact he was able to come up with the exact gun and sell it for thousands of dollars has been proven to be just totally false. And
Cobb said he thought it was a pistol, actually.
That's right.
He wasn't even sure what it was.
So this book is not only a great read, it's one of the problems of writing about past history is there's no first-hand accounts. Cobb stopped playing in 1928. There's no one around alive who saw him actually play. There was no film footage of him actually playing because he played for the Tigers and there wasn't any. So most all of it had to be based on newspaper accounts. And newspapers in those times not only didn't report what really went on because they were using purple prose all the time, but at the same time would tend to write things up in a much more florid, powerful way than they do now and sensationalize things. So if you're interested in the real story of Ty Cobb, I recommend you get a hold of this book. It's a very academic read, tremendous amounts of research, but it's a great story of the greatest man who ever played this ball.
Yep. And if you can't get a hold of the book by Al Stump, they actually made a movie called Cobb, where Tommy Lee Jones plays Ty Cobb and Robert Wool plays Al Stump. And again, even in the movie, it makes it seem like Al Stump kind of lived with Ty Cobb for a few months and wrote about him, and that wasn't the case at all, as we come to find out. But it gets into the bad aspects of Cobb, that he was a heavy drinker, he was a big racist, he was a very tough man to get along with, and it might be just a nice idea, if you can't get the book, to watch the movie before you read this new Ty Cobb book to give you some perspective.
As I recall, the movie begins with Cobb racing madly down a mountainside, yes, covered with snow in a car. Bradley going, I think he did go off the road,
yes, yes,
just to show his manic behavior all the way through. Just as a suggestion, I like to sort of, people that like to read about baseball as well, just to suggest this book. It's by, let me see again, his name is Charles Learson, L-E-E-R-H-S-E-N, and it's available on Amazon or any bookstores. It's just been published. So we're going to talk about no hitters. Jake, why don't you define exactly what a no-hitter is?
A no-hitter, for those of you who aren't fanatical baseball fans like we are, a no-hitter is when a pitcher pitches the entire game without giving up a hit to the other team. So the game's over, 9 innings, the other team doesn't have a hit. Now, what qualifies as a no-hitter, someone can reach base and it can still be a no-hitter, which we'll get into later on. It doesn't have to be a perfect game. But that's the official definition of a no-hitter, when the game is ended and there are no hits allowed.
Now, in 1991, the Committee for Statistical Accuracy of the MLB determined that they had to filter out all the no-hitters that didn't fit that definition. Previously combined no-hitters counted. A shortened game no-hitter, Darren Hanzak pitched a 5-inning no-hitter for the Sox in 95. That was stricken from the records. or a fellow that pitches at least 9 innings but loses it in extra innings. Was all stricken from the record, so now it has to be a full 9-inning game. But it's okay if you get on base, and there are actually 7 ways to get on base without getting a hit. Can you name any?
Well, the obvious 3 are a walk and a hit. A walk, an error, and a hit batsman. It's a walk, an error, hit batsman are the first 3 that spring to mind, but there are 4 others that are sort of not as obvious as those 3.
Okay, on a third strike, if the catcher misses the ball, wild pitch or pass ball, he runs to first, and gets the first that way. If there's a man on in a walk, and a ground ball is hit to the shortstop, he forces the guy at second base, that's called a fielder's choice, so the batter also can reach that way. You can get on a catcher's interference. If you swing and you hit the catcher, they put you on base that way. And the third one would probably be, let me think of one. A force play.
Same thing.
So there's actually you can score runs. Say for instance, first guy up walks. Second guy reaches on an error. Third guy's hit by a pitch. And the fourth guy hits a sacrifice fly. You score a run, no hits. That happens quite often.
Does happen quite a bit.
And in some of these no-hitters that have happened, there have been multiple base runners, but still no one reaches base.
No one gets a hit in the course of the game. Yeah, we'll get into some famous no-hitters. So
that's what a no-hitter happens. Now, the perfect no-hitter, of course, is called a perfect game. That is when no one reaches base through 9 innings at all. That's very rare. There's only been 18 in the post-war era when that has happened. Interestingly, there isn't a heck of a lot of difference in appreciation of the two. A no-hitter is a no-hitter. It's a great achievement. If it's a perfect game, that's a little fillip to it. But they don't make much difference when someone who you don't remember the perfect games, with one exception.
It's still in your record as, when you go in the Hall of Fame or if it's just on your Wikipedia entry, it'll say no-hitter, perfect game, and one really isn't, given more sway than the other.
And I should say the Red Sox have never had a perfect game in their whole history.
Yeah. So that's how rare those are.
That's right. Now, what's exactly the attraction of a no-hitter? Why do people pay so much attention to that? And to us, the basic attraction of a no-hitter is that it is unique of sports achievements in that it takes 3 hours to occur.
Right. When you're watching a football game, the big play is the touchdown, or basketball game, the guy hits a three-pointer at the buzzer, or there in baseball, there's a walk-off hit. A no-hitter just sort of germinates over the course of the game, and it's something you really don't even notice till the midway point of the game. After 5 or 6 innings, you might say, oh, this guy is a no-hitter. We'll tune in, and what happens is now, in the age of media, other TV channels will cut in and start televising when people have no-hitters after 6 or 7 innings. And there's a whole buildup of tension that happens to it that is really unique among sports and just particular to that event.
The teams themselves don't really notice. Hey, he's going to hit you at 4th, 5th inning. About the start of the 7th inning, so my God, he's got a no-hitter. And then every out becomes a tension builder. Mm-hmm. To the point where in the last 2 innings, the crowd is dinged, people are going crazy, and it just builds and builds and builds. And like you said, other stations will cut in by the 9th inning to see if he's able to hold it or not. And the best thing about the no-hitter is that it could be gone just like that at any moment over this time. It's like you hear the crowd go, the air goes out of the hall, and the pitcher hangs his head. Yeah. He's pitched a fabulous game, but it's not a no-hitter. And so that's part of the attraction of it, is that it could be gone at any moment. All this time, this build-up, poof, it's gone.
And with very rare exceptions, if it happens on the road, the home team will start to root for the road pitcher to get the no-hitter in most circumstances, because it's just something that doesn't happen very often, and it's just so unique to neither one of us have ever seen a no-hitter live.
All the games we've seen. And another thing about it, too, is it's relatively frequent. They're an average of about 2 a year, so it's not like the triple play that you never see, or the hitting for the cycle, which Red Sox haven't done for like 20 years.
Or 4 homers in a game.
Some of the other great achievements. A no-hitter could happen often enough so you can anticipate it all the time. And so because of that, all these superstitions build up around the no-hitter. For a long time, it was believed you don't ever mention it. If you mention it, you're going to jinx it. And that goes to people sitting at home on TV. You're going to stand and see, I can't go to the bathroom now. I can't go to the drink because I'm going to jinx the guy.
It even extended to the broadcasters, too. For a long time, the broadcasters never said the words no-hitter. They'd say, well, there's no one has reached base yet.
Oh, they'll show the scoreboard. Yeah, they'll show the 0-0-0 out there. Nothing's on there. I remember one time Mickey Mantle talked about the time, we'll talk about the greatest no-hitter of all time at the end of the show, when Don Lasky was pitching his perfect game in the World Series. He would sit down after each inning and try to talk to people. I'm throwing a no-hitter. What do you think? What do you think? And they would move away from him. And Mantle said at the end of that no-hitter, he was all by himself on one side of the dugout. The entire team was plastered up the other side so as not to break the jinx. So there's superstitions around it, so you don't want to break that jinx.
And there's some other interesting things that happen. You know, we've talked about decommissioning no-hitters before. Well, there are some pretty amazing pitching achievements that are famous for not being no-hitters.
Right.
Like, perfect example.
Close calls.
Yes.
Almost no-hitters, right.
Well, there's a pitcher, pitch for the Pirates named Harvey Haddix, who was their ace at the time. He actually managed to pitch 12 perfect innings in a game. The problem is the Pirates didn't score either. So heading into the 13th inning, there was still no score, and he ended up losing his perfect game, I think, on an error and a walk and then a stolen base. Then finally, and Joe Adcock hit a three-run homer, but in the course of the home run, the runner got confused, and he ended up passing another runner. So Haddix lost his perfect game in the 13th and lost the game 1-0
on a three-run homer.
So go figure that one out.
So he's more famous for not getting the perfect game.
But he had the 12 perfect innings. It was one of the best games ever pitched, but he didn't get the no-hitter. And something more recent than that, Pedro Martinez did that when he was with the Expos. He had a 9-inning perfect game. The Expos couldn't score, so he stayed up till the 10th inning, and in the 10th inning, he finally gave up a hit and lost his perfect game.
So, my favorite one, though, still. This happened way back in 1917 when Babe Ruth was a pitcher for the Red Sox, primarily a pitcher at that point. Things were a little different in those days. In an afternoon game, he walked the first batter, was so infuriated by the umpire's calls that he walked out to the umpire and punched him smack in the mouth. Wound up and hauled him and flattened the umpire. Of course, he was ejected from the game, and a fellow named Ernie Shore came in to relieve him. The runner tried to steal second and was thrown out, and Shore retired the next 26 guys. So for a long time, it was always recorded as a no-hitter / perfect game. But since this commission came along, that's been expunged too. So those are just three examples not no-hitters, not official no-hitters, that became, you know, more famous than some of the no-hitters.
And the near misses are just as famous as the ones who did do it. Like 1967 was the famous one for you.
That's right.
I was not around then, but that's you could talk about that one. That was a famous one with Mr. Roar.
Billy Roar. Billy Roar, 1967 is known as the impossible dream. That was the team, the Red Sox have been terrible for quite a while. In 1966, they lost 100 games, but they had a new manager, Dick Williams, who just come in. He said, we're going to win as many as we lose. And in the very early game against the Yankees at Yankee Stadium, a rookie pitcher named Billy Roar, spelled R-O-H-R, was on the mound, and sure in the devil, going to the ninth inning, he had a no-hitter. The leadoff batter for the Yankees was Tommy Tresh, and he had a blast to left field. And Yaz went back and made one of the greatest catches in Major League history. Running back was diving backwards and caught the ball, and the place went absolutely berserk, even though it was in Yankee Stadium. He retired in the next batter, so he's one out away, and Elston Howard comes up and hits a little sad bloop into the outfield in front of Tony Canigliaro to end it. He retired the next batter. That is the impetus for the impossible dream. They always say that was the spark that said the Red Sox, this kid could leave him. He went on to do nothing else after it. But it was just a remarkable achievement in a near no-hitter that became as famous as anything else that happened in that series.
Yep. And there are actually two times where a near-miss perfect game has been just as famous as a regular perfect game. I'm sure you remember this. In 2001, there was one where Mike Mussina was nearing a perfect game against the Red Sox in Fenway Park. And I think it was a 3-0 game.
And the place was actually kind of rooting for Messina to get the perfect game, even though he was a Yankee. He got to two outs in the eighth, in the ninth inning. He had one batter to go, and Carl Everett came up to pinch hit. And nobody could stand Carl Everett.
Either in the stands or on his own team.
Yeah,
that was the bad
boy. Red Sox hated him. And he came up with two outs in the ninth as a pinch hitter, and in a little flare into left field that fell in for a hit, and it broke up the perfect game with two outs in the ninth.
So you've seen, instead of being everlasting, nobody remembers it at all.
No, nope, was gone. Unless you're watching the game, you'd never think anything of it. But the really famous one happened about 5 years ago. A pitcher for the Tigers named Armando Galarraga, who was not a household name at all, had a perfect game heading into the ninth inning. He got the first 26 guys out. He was one out away from a perfect game.
Great.
And there was a grounder to the first baseman. Galarraga went over to cover the bag to take the throw. And he took the throw from the first baseman, and the runner was clearly out by about half a step. And the umpire, Jim Joyce, who's a great umpire, is one of the best umps in the business, called the runner safe. And the place was, everyone was beside themselves. Joyce was about the only person in the stadium that thought this, the runner was safe.
Yeah.
And it and Galarraga lost his perfect game, and he never did anything else of note.
And
he got the pitch
that
to
play
years.
Became the impetus for instant replay.
Yep.
See, today that would never possibly happen, but that was the major argument for going into instant replay, which has changed the whole face of the ballgame, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
The arguments are gone, and they get it right most all the time now with calling to New York and checking it out for a couple minutes. But that was a classic one.
And to his credit, after the game, Jim Joyce was in tears at the press conference. He said, I blew the call. I blew this kid's perfect game. And the next day, he came out and shook hands with the pitcher. And, you know, he was forgiven for it, unlike some other umps that have blown calls because he just confessed that I missed it. But that's a great example of a near-miss perfect game that's more famous than an actual perfect game.
You always mention Dave Steeb.
Oh, yeah, Dave Steeb. Oh, talk about Carl Everett of the Blue Jays in the 80s. Dave Steeb was the ace of the Blue Jays in the 80s. And I believe it was the 85 season. Two starts in a row, he was one out from a no-hitter, and he lost it with two outs in the ninth. I think the second game, he lost it on a home run, and his teammates were glad. They hated him so much, it's so good, I'm glad he didn't get the no-hitter. He eventually did get one, I think, two or three years later.
Right,
but two starts in a row,
consecutive.
He was one out away from a no-hitter. So those are just some fun things to store away, and that's what's cool about a no-hitter, is that as it's progressing, as we said, the tension builds, and at any moment it's gone. For whatever reason.
Just like that, and it doesn't necessarily the best hitters either. Some scrub comes up and flares one in, you know, and also a few have been saved by fabulous fielding plays.
Oh, sure, the famous one, Mark Burley's perfect game. Dwayne Wise caught a ball that would have been a home run. Probably any other center fielder wouldn't have gotten to it, and he reached over the wall and caught it. And it was in the ninth inning.
Right.
It was with the two outs to go, and Burley got his perfect game thanks to that great catch. And what's really interesting about a no-hitter is that when it turns into one-hitter, nobody cares, and the tension is gone. Say you get that hit in the first inning, nobody talks about it.
Now, I've never seen a no-hitter, but I have seen a one-hitter, and it was in the first inning.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't pay any attention. At the end of the game, that was a one-hitter. That was pretty good.
Yeah.
Which is still a pretty remarkable achievement when you think about it.
Yeah.
Now, we said it is a fairly frequent occurrence. There have been 289 official no-hitters by these rules. 289.
There was one three or four days ago. Not Charlton Heston. Chris Heston of the Giants just pitched one earlier this week for number 289 in the record books.
He's a rookie.
Yep, rookie.
So. Never heard his name before, but there's a new one.
And just like we were talking about, every channel cut in and you saw the last three innings of the game. And it's something that the fans at home watching are always rooting for, too. Unless it's a team that you hate or pick for whatever reason. Everyone always roots for the no-hitter to happen just to say, oh, I was watching that.
There have been 22 pitchers who have two or more no-hitters. And so we thought we would just highlight half a dozen of those that were especially notable. Johnny Vandermeer, 1938, pitched two consecutive no-hitters. Never close to becoming accomplished since. And one of them was the first night game in Brooklyn. First time he was ever played a night game there, which may have added to it, perhaps. He was called Ewell the Whip. He had a big sidearm motion that he threw it in through her. And so he sort of popularized the concept of no-hitters, and people would hope he never did it again. But he had two consecutive ones.
Yeah, and more recently, I'm sure people remember Roy Halladay, who's one of the handful of people who has a no-hitter for more than one team. He had one with the Blue Jays, and his one with the Phillies was in the playoffs. It's one of only two no-hitters ever to be thrown in the playoffs. So I think it was 2006, maybe, 2007. Very recent.
Yeah. Then there's a fellow named Jim Abbott. Some of you might remember him. Jim Abbott pitched for the Angels primarily, but he came and played for the Yankees for a while. He had one hand. It was remarkable how he could throw, and as he threw, flip his glove over to his good hand so he'd be in position to field. He threw a no-hitter with one hand. That was just an extraordinary occurrence. He actually had a fairly decent career as a handicapped pitcher.
And another one, very famous one, Sandy Koufax is actually second all-time with four no-hitters, and I think he did it in a six-year span.
Yes.
He only really had 6 good years in his career. So imagine that, four no-hitters in one career is extraordinary, second best ever, but it happened in such a short time span. That's how dominant he was for his
He did have two in one season, actually.
Yes.
Another one is Cy Young, the famous Cy Young. He had three no-hitters, two with the Red Sox. He's the only Red Sox to have more than one no-hitter in his career.
And another really unique one, Bob Feller, who was probably the hardest thrower of his era, almost threw nothing but fastballs, had three no-hitters, and one was on opening day against the White Sox.
Only opening day. Yeah. Tell the great trivia.
Yeah, so the White Sox, at the beginning of the day, the team had a zero batting average. At the end of the day, the whole team still had a zero batting average, just nobody got a hit.
You could go nets and bars with that one.
Yeah.
What team went a whole game without getting a hit didn't change their batting average?
Well, speaking of trivia, we have some great trivia questions for you to ponder for the rest of the show, as we always do. So this is the JV question here. See if you can name one of the three pitchers who have the most career wins who have never thrown a no-hitter. We'll take any one of the three, but there are three very famous pitchers with a lot of wins who have never thrown a no-hitter.
So that should be able something probably a lot of people can guess.
Now here's the varsity question. What pitcher had the least career wins and still threw a no-hitter? That's something to really ponder.
If you could rattle that one off.
Yeah, if you know this one, you're really a baseball
guest. You can become a guest on our show.
Yes, we know that one. So think about those while we're trekking through the rest of the show and see if you can figure any of them out.
Now, we cannot do a show about no-hitters without talking about Nolan Ryan.
Mm-hmm.
Nolan Ryan was an extraordinary person. Not ball player, but just he had to be superhuman. The man had a phenomenal fastball, a phenomenal curveball, and a tremendously long career. Most people that are power pitchers don't last too long, especially one that isn't very big. The big guys like Clemens, with Tom Seaver, big, powerful bodies and powerful legs. And Nolan Ryan was not a big man, but he was an iron man. He threw 7 no-hitters. Seven no-hitters. In addition, he threw 12 one-hitters, which ties Bob Feller for the most one-hitters.
Yeah,
so he had this extraordinary number of games.
And he was throwing in the mid-90s at age 45 or 46 when he retired.
He threw his seventh no-hitter at the age of 44, when most of us are applying for Medicaid and cards. He was still throwing his hardest.
And still throwing 95.
17 years between his first and last no-hitters. Imagine that. He also had 5,700 strikeouts, only one to pass 5,000, way ahead of number two.
Yeah.
He had 324 wins, and most of those were with mediocre teams.
I think the 86 Astros were about the only
play for the Mets and the Angels, the Rangers, and Houston, none of which were good teams. He played just a little bit, never played in the World Series, the fact that he was able to amass that many wins with such a poor team. And he's in the Hall of Fame. Now, referring back to our last show,
yes.
Six people didn't vote for him. Now, can you imagine with the kind of track record and the numbers he put up? Six people said, Nolan Ryan, nah,
no.
Maybe next year.
Yeah. So this leads into something else. On the other side of the coin from Nolan Ryan, are people who have had not so extraordinary careers that have pitched a no-hitter. And a lot of it, as we were talking about, is luck. A lot of it is just, you don't get a dying quail that falls in for a hit. There isn't a little grounder that somebody beats out for a single. It's just a lot of luck sometimes. And, you know, Nolan Ryan is famous for his 7 no-hitters. Well, there are a couple people I just thought I'd mention who do have no-hitters, and in one case, a perfect game. We're not exactly perfect. We're not exactly household names.
Jason loves this kind of stuff.
Yeah, this is my kind of stuff
this
here.
This is his bailiwick.
My favorite no-hitter is a guy called Mike Warren. Pitched for the A's in 1983, had a 3-year career, had 9 career wins. One of them was a no-hitter. It was the last weekend of the 1983 season against the White Sox, who had a 20-game lead in the AL West, and they were gearing up for the playoffs. They really didn't care about winning at that point. So they threw a bunch of chumps out in the lineup, and Warren pitched a no-hitter. Only complete game of his career, only shutout of his career. And on the other side was much more recently, 2012, Philip Humber, who pitched for the White Sox, had a perfect game, and the next year, the White Sox traded him to the Astros. 2013, went 0-8 for the Astros, who were the worst team in baseball at the time, so they could have used some pitching help. And right now he's in Korea trying to resurrect his pitching career. So he goes from a perfect game to out of the majors in 3 years. So just goes to show the other side of the coin from Nolan Ryan to Philip Humber and Mike Warren.
Now we're going to talk quite a bit of the rest of the show about Red Sox no-hitters, but first,
we have
a Channel 9 exclusive.
Exclusive.
Yeah. Nolan Ryan, we've been talking about, was a fearsome pitcher. But there was an occasion when a fellow named Robin Ventura, who is the current manager of the White Sox, was hit by a pitch and made the very grievous error of charging the mound. As he ran from the mound, ran toward the mound, most pitchers will throw their glove or duck or try to be protected. Ryan reached out, grabbed him by the neck, tucked him under his arm, and pounded him in the head until they were broken up. And so we would like to put forth the point that he actually had 8 no-hitters. Here comes Ventura, got no hits on Ryan at all.
Yeah.
There's a little clip here where you can see the futility of trying to attack Nolan Ryan on the mound and showing off his 8th no-hitter.
Here's Ventura, RBI single in the first. Watch out. Look at this.
And Ryan did say later on, that's how I bring down the steer on my ranch. So that's how he took out Ventura when he ran out after him. So you heard it here first. He actually has an 8th no-hitter. So yeah, let's get into the
We're
Red Sox.
Move into the Red Sox no-hitters. Now, the Red Sox in their entire team franchise history have 18 no-hitters. 10 of them were back 1923 or older, so we'll just skip over those other than the one we talked about with Ernie Shore. But in my lifetime, in fact, my fan time, there have been 8 no-hitters. So I'd like to just quickly detail each one of them. And for the last 4, the ones that have been in this century, we've actually got some film clips of the last outlet to keep all in short. On July 14th, 1956, a Red Sox stalwart pitcher named Mel Parnell threw a no-hitter at Fenway Park against the White Sox, winning 4-0. It was the first Red Sox no-hitter since 1923, some 33 years since the last one. Parnell had won 25 games in 1949, 21 games in 53, but he was at the very end of his career, had been hurt most of the year. And this one particular game, he just happened to have it all together. There's a clip that you'll see here. Of my scrapbook that I was keeping at the time with a headline, "I was just lucky," said Mel. And this is kind of cute. Immediately after the game, the team owner, Tom Yawkey, came into the clubhouse and gave him a $500 raise in salary.
Yes. Gee.
Get that $500 raise?
And at the time, that was a big deal.
It was a great deal. They fined people $20,000 for yelling at the umpire these days. That shows you what the finances were at the time. It was just a remarkable thing that they would consider that a lot of money. And he was through with baseball shortly after that. But that was the breakthrough of breaking the ice of the Red Sox no-hitters. Then the next one was quite remarkable. It was pitched by Earl Wilson on June 26, 1942, again at Fenway against the Angels. They went 2-0. Wilson is one of the two or three pitchers who have the most home runs in their careers. He had over 30 home runs, and he hit a home run in his no-hitter, one of only three pitchers ever to do that. He is also the only black pitcher to hit a no-hitter for the Red Sox, and was the first black pitcher in the American League to do the same thing. And he beat Bo Bolinski, who had thrown a no-hitter himself earlier that season. And what's the chances of that whole combination happening? Unlike Parnell, he went on to have quite a career afterwards, became a pitcher for the Tigers, and did win 20 games for the Tigers later on.
So the next one, the next no-hitter actually happened about 6 weeks later. Bill Bombiquette, who was the ace of some pretty bad Red Sox teams in the late 50s, early 60s, pitched a no-hitter, and he also held until Roger Clemens broke the record. He had the most strikeouts in any game by a Red Sox pitcher. He struck out 17 in one game until Clemens broke it with 20 strikeouts.
Jason his mother were all at that game when it happened. We were actually at the 20-strikeout game. I remember sitting there as the totals going, Bombiquette has the record.
Yeah.
Because that was a big deal. He actually did it in an away game in Washington.
Yeah, and it was a perfect one walk away from a perfect game. And we have to give him a little extra love because he's a local guy. He's from Medford.
And the Red Sox used to work out in the Tufts cage in the wintertime where I went to college. And just a cute little story, we used to have our class pictures taken down in the cousin's gym where he would be working out. And after workout one day, he was just up watching the photographer. When I sat down to have my picture taken, he walked behind the photographer, put the rabbit ears up on it. So my class picture has this big grin on my face because Bombiquette was doing that. And many, many years later, we get a chance to meet him, and there's a picture here of my wife sitting with an elderly Bill Bombiquette, who unfortunately just recently passed away in the last month or two. But he was one of our no-hit crew.
Yeah, and later on, the couple years later, 1965, again, the Red Sox were terrible, but it was a one fluke thing that happened. Dave Moorhead, who was a rookie then, pitched a no-hitter against Cleveland, and again, was one walk away from a perfect game. He walked Rocky Colavito on a 3-2 pitch. And interesting, in that game, the losing pitcher was Louis Tiant. Before he joined the Red Sox,
that's right,
he was just starting out with the Indians, and he was the losing pitcher in that game.
He was early on in his career, because in 68, he led the American League with a 1.2 earned run average, something like that. And Bob Gibson were the reasons they lowered them out, because they had done so well that year.
And so before we head into the more recent no-hitters, there are just some interesting stats we have about various no-hitters that have happened pertaining to the Red Sox over the years. So first one was,
no-hitter against the Red Sox at Fenway, believe it or not, was 57 years ago. Jim Bunning, who later became a member of Congress.
Yes, now Senator Jim Bunning.
Senator Jim Bunning threw a no-hitter against them. I can remember sitting out my yard being very upset that they just did a no-hit. But there has not been a no-hitter against the Sox at Fenway for 57 years, so that's good.
Yeah. And the first no-hitter against the Red Sox in my memory was thrown by Dave Righetti in 1984. It was on July 4th. We were staying at our family house in Holland. It was over 100 degrees that day. And it was very stifling in the house, but we couldn't keep our eyes away because he was pitching a no-hitter. And what's interesting is that within a couple of years, he became a full-time reliever and for quite a few years actually held the record for most saves in one season.
Right.
But when in his younger years, he was a starter and he just had everything going against the Sox that day.
And it was against the Yankees.
Yeah, right. So it was
on the
4th
of July.
Yeah.
He struck out Wade Boggs to end the game. We were so disheartened.
Yeah. It was back in the TV 38 days with Ned Martin and Bob Montgomery, sure as I remember. And they, of course, televised every July 4th, so we watched it as it happened.
Now, there hasn't been another no-hitter against the Red Sox in the last 21 years, and the last one that was very, very forgettable because it was at Seattle.
Yeah.
At 10 o'clock at night, so it wasn't seen by too many people.
In 1993, when the team was terrible, that was the Butch Hobson era.
We seem to be saying the Red Sox were terrible.
Yeah, that's a theme here. And it was by a pitcher named Chris Bosio, who's now the pitching coach for the Cubs, and I think he was pitching coach for the Brewers for a while, too. And what's really interesting is that he walked the first two batters of the game and then got the next 27 outs. So minus the first two batters, he actually had a perfect game. But again, it was a West Coast game, and I think we may have been the only people staying up to watch it at that point.
Actually, I've seen more of him now. He's the Cubs pitching coach.
Yeah.
He's sort of built like a hydrant.
Yeah, he's
still around, and every time he comes out, he says, that's the last guy.
Yeah, it's the last guy. And again, kind of a nondescript career, but that's the way no-hitters work.
Right. So now we get to the last four, and probably a lot of people out in the audience will remember these four, because they're all in this century. And these people were pretty much not just one-hit wonders, one-game wonders. In April 4th on 2001, at Baltimore, Hideo Nomo, who was one of our first Japanese players, in his first appearance with the Red Sox, he'd been playing with the Dodgers prior to that, threw a no-hitter. It was the only no-hitter at Camden Yards to date, the only one in Baltimore in their entire history. He was 32 years old, he just started, and it was he had thrown the first no-hitter against the Rockies earlier, and the interesting fact about this was that it was the first game that Don Orsillo ever telecast. And just starting out your telecasting career, telecasting a no-hitter on the road. And we don't have a clip of it. We have a clip of it, but it's by the Baltimore announcer. Understandably, he's not too excited about the occasion.
And there's never been a no-hitter at Camden Yards. Fly ball, shallow left. This could do it. O'Leary, Hideo Nomo has spun the no-no against the Orioles. The second time in his major league career, the baseball record books await that young man from Japan, Hideo Nomo. Second career no-hitter, first time, did it as a member of the LA Dodgers. Oh yeah, you know he's the Heineken star of the game. No-hit performance from Nomo against the Birds tonight at the Yard.
That was the first one.
And another interesting part of that is that the Red Sox in that game only had 5 hits. They won 3-0. Brian Daubak hit 2 homers for their 3 runs. So the offense in the entire game was one person. So a little side note on that one. And the next one, a lot of people were watching this one, was Derek Lowe. This was at Fenway Park in April 2002. It was against Tampa Bay. It was the first no-hitter at Fenway in 37 years. And again, this seems to be a theme, had one walk. He was one walk away from a perfect game. And it was the biggest no-hit margin in franchise history to that point. They won the game 10-0.
All right, Lowe stands back of the rubber, takes a look into the crowd, now places the ball in his glove, right arm dangling at his side. Lanky right-hander is ready. 2-2 pitches, swung on and bounced to second base. Sanchez to Offerman, a no-hitter. Lowe is mobbed by his teammates. A standing ovation all the way around Fenway Park. The first no-hitter here by a Red Sox pitcher since Dave Moorhead in 1965.
It's a terrible Tampa Bay team, and I actually have to get this lineup out for you because you wouldn't believe, if you're ever going to throw a no-hitter against a team, this was the one to do it. This was Tampa Bay's lineup that game. Now, see how many names on here you recognize, because I sure as heck don't know a couple of them. Jason Tyner, Randy Wynn, Steve Cox, Toby Hall, who was their catcher hitting cleanup, Ben Grieve Jr., Greg Vaughn, who you may know, but was completely at the end of the line. I think it was his last season. Brett Abernathy, somebody named Johnson at third base. I don't even know which Johnson it is. And somebody named Escalona. Now, if that's not a bad lineup to no hit, I mean, talk about just having it brought right to you. Because the Tampa Bay was just horrible at the time. So that was not to downgrade Derek Lowe's achievement at all. But if you're going to pick a lineup to no hit, that's probably the easiest one.
I'm sure there's some coaches out there who will say, well, there's still major leaguers.
There's still major leaguers.
So you never know. Yeah. It could happen any time.
But I thought it would be fun to run through that lineup because name any of those guys. My word.
Now, the next one is pitching. Actually, as we take this tonight,
yes,
Clay Buchholz. Yep. It is rookie year. I believe it was his first or second appearance.
Second start.
Second start with the Red Sox. Yep. September 1st, 2007. No hit Baltimore. Again, 10-0.
1-2 the count to Nick Markakis. Two down in the ninth. All zeros tonight for Baltimore. Curveball. The 1-2 pitch. He struck him out! Clay Buchholz has thrown a no-hitter in Boston tonight, and it sends Fenway into a frenzy!
No-hitters, a 1-0 game, there's still a lot of tension. I remember when we were coming to the 20 strikeout game, yeah. He was losing that game 1-0 until the last of the seventh inning. Right. So he wanted the record to happen, but damn, you wanted to win the ball game too,
yeah,
at the same time?
Right.
But the 10-0 games, just, in fact, let's just make outs ourselves so we can get back to the yeah, pitching
stuff. Right, right. And when we're talking about the tension of a no-hitter, the funny thing is that half the time the pitcher isn't even involved in the game. Your team is up at bat. So, okay, let's just get through the offensive part and get back to the defense so we can see if the no-hitter happens.
And what does he do in the dugout? Nobody wants to talk to him. Yeah. Should I go to the bathroom? That might break up the thing. Should I have some Gatorade? Yeah. I mean, that'll break up the thing. What does he do? Just sits there and all he can be is yeah. Because some pitches, I wasn't aware I had a no-hitter.
Right. Right. And a little fun fact about that game is you can also win a bar bet with this one. Who was the DH for the Orioles that game again when Buchholz pitched the no-hitter? It was Kevin Millar. He was, I think it was the last year of his career. He was the DH for the Orioles that game, and he got one of the three walks that Buchholz gave up.
That's right.
So, a little trivia note there for you.
Kevin, all the ladies love Kevin.
All the ladies love Kevin Millar.
We have a signed Kevin Millar shirt up at our theater. Yeah.
And the most recent no-hitter, again, is by someone who's still pitching, just not for the Red Sox. It was by John Lester. And he did it against the Royals at Fenway Park, won 7-0. And this was a real emotional one because, for those who don't know, in 2006, he was diagnosed with cancer. And he had to completely give up baseball for a while he was going through his recovery for cancer. And he came back the next year in 2007 and actually participated in the World Series win the previous year. And 2008 was the year he really started to become the ace pitcher that he'd become later on for the Red Sox.
This was in May, and you figured he was finally back to health. Mm-hmm. It was an unbelievably emotional scene when he did it. The place, not only because of the achievement, but because of who had done this and his nature, I can still, it's touching to see the video of Frank Kona coming out and embracing him. Frank Kona, it was like a son to him.
Yeah, he said
and that. It was like, good for you. You've recovered. You've beaten cancer. And the hell of the game. Look what you've been able to do.
One ball, two strikes, two outs, ninth inning. Glasnow strikes out. John Lester's thrown a no-hitter at Fenway. He no-hits the Kansas City Royals.
Thank you. it's still one of the, I think, one of the great moments in no-hitter history.
And again, so unexpected. And that's what makes no-hitters great. It was just, you had no way of knowing that this was going to happen.
And he was dominating, but you can be dominating and still not get a no-hitter.
Sure. Yep. Greatest pitching performance I ever saw was Pedro against the Yankees, and it was a one-hitter. So
struck out 17 Yankees. They allowed one base runner, but it was a home run in the second inning, so there really was no tension.
Yeah. But it's so funny how you can be dominating and still not get a no-hitter.
So just for the fun of it, before we close here, Jason's picked a couple of people who've had the best no-hitter and the worst.
There's some really
They're all no-hitters, but the best and the worst.
We're going to scale some of the no-hitters here. Probably the most remarkable, impressive no-hitter was pitched by Hideo Nomo, who we talked about before, but not for the Red Sox when he was with the Dodgers. And it was the fact that he did it in Coors Field, which, and this is the days before the humidor. Coors Field was the most offensive park in baseball history. The Rockies broke all sorts of offensive records.
It was a small park. It was mile high. The ball was like hitting on the moon.
Yeah. And the offense at the time broke all kinds of records. And Nomo did it in Coors Field against the Rockies lineup that had Alex Burks, Dante Bichette, Andres Galarraga, just a whole laundry list of
7,300 hitters at the time.
Yeah, seven of the nine. Guy. Well, 7 of the 8. The pitcher really doesn't count. But 7 of the 8.
He was hitting 300 as well.
Oh, was he really?
He was hitting 300 as well at the time, right.
So it goes to show just how dominant Nomo was that game, that he was able to do it in Coors Field against that lineup. So on the other side, we have the worst no-hitter ever. And there was just a movie made about this a few months ago. There was a pitcher for the Pirates in 1970 named Doc Ellis.
Where do you see the clip after this?
And he claimed, and it turned out to be true, he was on LSD at the time that he pitched his no-hitter.
During the time when I was pitching the no-hitter in San Diego, I really didn't know, I didn't see the hitters. All I could tell was if they was on the right side or the left side. As far as seeing the target, the catcher put tape on his fingers so I could see the signals. But as far as seeing the batter himself, I didn't really see who they were. The opposing team and my teammates, they knew I was high, but they didn't know what I was high on. They didn't really see it, but I had the acid in me, and I didn't know what I looked like with that acid. I had lost all concept of time. It was easier to pitch with the LSD because I was so used to medicating myself. That's the way I was dealing with the fear of failure. You know, if Doc's pitching, we know it's high. How high is it? I pitched every game in the major leagues under the influence of drugs.
He was known for being a heavy drinker, often coming, perhaps having 1-3 too many or being hungover, but he was on LSD throughout the game. Now, he walked 8 guys. He hit 3 other guys, and he was so all over the place. He said, I never really knew where the plate was. I could just tell which side of the plate the batters were on, so no one was going to stand in against this maniac or this situation. And you can see in this clip, which is kind of... It wasn't done professionally, that he was just walking around half the time. He managed to get 27 outs. That's got to be the worst no-hitter of all time.
And imagine if you're a hitter. Okay, this guy's high on LSD. He's walking 8 and hitting 3. I'm just standing in the back corner of the batter's box hoping I don't get killed in the process.
We'll give you this game.
We'll punt this one. Yeah.
You expect him sort of to fly off with a white rabbit after a while, you know. Now, to end this, we both have been talking about this quite a bit recently, and I think there will be fewer no-hitters as time goes on, primarily because pitchers don't pitch complete games anymore. They don't want pitchers to pitch complete games anymore. They have an expensive bullpen. They're paying pitchers millions and millions of dollars, and there's no point to it. It used to be a point of honor. We were talking about unbreakable records earlier for maybe a future show. A lot of the pitchers had 30, 35 complete games. You didn't come out of a game. You stayed in the whole game. Mm-hmm. Now, if you pitch seven innings, you've had a quality start. The poor Red Sox tried to get guys to the fifth or sixth inning. Yeah. And so who was going to pitch that long? Why would a manager leave a pitcher in? There's a terrific story in Sports Illustrated this week about one of the people who was one of the greatest pitchers of the last decade, called Johan Santana. Terrific pitcher for the Twins. The Mets picked him up, and he became afflicted with arm trouble. And he was out and out and out. He tried to come back, and he was having a terrific start. Five innings, no hitter. Six innings, no hitter. In the seventh inning, he reached his maximum pitch count. But the Mets have never had a no-hitter pitch for them at this point. The crowd is going berserk. And the managers say, please somebody get a hit on this guy. Please bloop one in. Seventh inning goes by. Eighth inning, he passes the 120 pitch count. He pitched a no-hitter. He made it. Place goes nuts. He pitched 130 pitches, and he was done for a career.
It was pretty much the last game
so
he ever pitched.
So this story, if you get a chance to pick up this week, so you'll have to... June 13th issue of Sports Illustrated. I'll read through it because it would indicate why no-hitters are very, very unlikely to happen any longer.
And like you said, the bullpens are stronger too. Why would you have a guy who's tiring pitch the last couple innings when you can have the fireballers come out of the bullpen who throw 100, pitch the 8th and 9th inning? That's what they get paid.
It's like you're paying Miller for the Yankees $10 million. That's what he's there for. Right. So the no-hitters will probably be scarce. Although... on the other hand,
We just had one. But it's at the point where, unless a pitcher has a no-hitter, you wouldn't leave him in the game for that long when it comes down to
it. And I can't think of the name, but in the last two or three years, someone was pulled with a no-hitter in the seventh inning. Mm-hmm. He reached the pitch count, it was early in the season, get him out. You know? And the crowd, of course, is going to leave him. Right. They pull him out anyway. Yeah.
But so to conclude the show here on our end anyway, we always... end with the trivia answers. I hope you've been rattling those around in your brain.
No Googling. We didn't
No Googling. So too late. But that's sort of implied by that. So if you got one of the three pitchers right, you can give yourself a pat on the back. So the three pitchers who have the most career wins without a no-hitter, one of them goes way back, one who has the most, Grover Cleveland Alexander, who I think is fifth all-time in wins. Yes. He's 370-something career wins.
He was called Old Pete, because even though he was only in his late 30s, he looked like he was 60.
Yeah.
Pitchers in those days drank a lot.
And he drank a lot. Yeah. But the other two are more recent, and you probably got one of these too, Greg Maddux and Roger Clemens. Neither one of them, in their great careers, ever had a no-hitter, which is pretty extraordinary.
Clemens even came close. I think once he had one in Texas into the eighth inning, but he never really came close to doing it.
And neither did Maddux. I think Maddux only got in the eighth once or twice. But if you get this varsity question, then you can come on the show with us. The pitcher who has the record for the least career wins with a no-hitter is a guy named Bobo Holloman. He pitched for the Browns. And he had three career wins, and he did it in his first career start.
That was it?
Yep, that was it. He had his first career start, had a no-hitter, and he was so bad for the Browns, who were bad anyway.
They moved to Baltimore.
They moved to Baltimore, yeah. He was a one-year wonder. He went 3-8 that season, and he was done after that. So if you got that right, you can come on our show and get some trivia questions right.
So I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope you especially enjoyed all the clips we were able to put together. They're all great, exciting moments. And so we'll sign off. Thanks, Jake, for joining us.
See you at the park.
See you anon. And watch this last clip. We'll conclude with Don Larson's fabulous no-hitter. Take care.
Larson is ready. Gets the sign. Two strikes, ball one. Here comes the pitch. Strike three. A no-hitter. A perfect game for Don Larson. Yogi Berra runs out there. He leaps on Larson. And he's swarmed by his teammates. No hitter, a perfect performance by Don Larson.